Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
I join Amira Presence and I joined Zoom as well.
Can you turn on your camera so we can see you?
Hello, Ken.
Ah, excellent. Thank you. Zingyu, if you can, if you're logged in, if you can take the presenter, then you should be able to advance the slides. So there's a plus sign in the lower right-hand corner. Do you see that? You should be able to take over the presentation controls on BBB.
You tell me which button?
Sorry, it's on the lower left-hand side. There is a blue round plus sign. If you click on that, you should be able to take the presentation, and then you will be able to control advancing the slides.
Okay.
Okay.
Excellent. So I can start it now.
Yes. So why don't you get started, and you'll be talking about investigating patch porting. So thank you. Why don't you get started?
Okay. So I'm Xing Yunli, and I'm from UC Riverside. So now I will present an investigation of patch porting practices of the Linux kernel ecosystem. So open source software is increasingly reused, complicating the process of patching to repair bugs. So Linux ecosystem is one of the biggest open source ecosystems, which is mainly composed of three parts, Linux mainline, Linux long-term support, and Linux distribution. So Linux mainline is a branch mainly for development and the place where patches are first introduced. So usually people will not use it for the production purpose in the real life. And then it is the Linux stable and the Linux long-term support branches. These branches are forked from the Linux mainline midwood, and they will only accept bug fixes from the Linux mainline. The difference between Linux stable and Linux long-term support is the lifetime. The former is usually maintained for 2 or 3 months, while the latter can be up to 6 years. And then it is Linux distribution. Linux distributions are forked from the Linux mainline. They propagate the patches from.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Sorry.
Okay.
If you want to back up, I think maybe 2 slides or 3. Yeah. Next slide. I think is where we lost you. Yep.
Okay. So the flow of patches or the in the Linux ecosystem is like a river. It is from the upstream to the downstream. So we can take a Linux mainline as the upstream since. Linux stable, Linux long-term support, Linux distributions will port patches from Linux mainline. So at the same time, Linux distributions, some Linux distributions will also port patches from the Linux stable and Linux long-term support branches. So Linux stable and long-term support branches can also be taken as the upstream. So downstream branches, such as different Linux distributions, rely on patch porting from the upstream, such as Linux mainline and Linux long-term support branches, to fix bugs and avoid the potential attack. But there is no systematic investigation into these practices. So we want to provide an investigation into these patch porting practices. Especially, we wanted to know what are the common passporting strategies employed by the downstream kernel maintainers, and what is the performance of these strategies in terms of three metrics that we defined, and how far away are they from the ideal? And finally, what improvements can be made to enhance the passporting practices? So to do this, we do a big scale measurement, and our measurement target includes 468,000 commits for 16 different Linux distribution branches and 7 Linux long-term support branches. So these branches, including 4 Ubuntu branches, 3 SLE branches, 4 Oracle UEK branches, 3 Amazon Linux 2 branches, and also Fedora and Arch. So here is the passporting practices that we summarized. So we noticed that there are some distributions which port patches from the Linux stable or long-term support branches in groups. So which means that they will port almost all patches within a Linux long-term support main version, such as Linux 5.10.3. Almost all commits within this main version will be ported to the downstream Linux distributions in groups. So for such cases, we call it either the group porting. And also, distribution maintainers can also choose to bypass the immediate Linux long-term support or Linux stable branches and directly port patches from Linux mainline. So when these patches are some urgent patches. So we found that such patches are usually driven by the bug tracking system maintained by the distributions and CVE IDs. So we call these as the individual picking. Different from selecting what patches to port, replace, and conditionally changes the base, the base itself to a given point in a target branch. For example, the latest Linux mainline, Linux stable main versions or the Linux long-term support main versions, and the rebase will automatically inherit all commits that are made to the target. At the same time, this rebase can be divided to the main version rebase and the major version rebase. So a main version rebase indicates that it rebase from one main version to another. So for example, from Linux 5.10.1 to 5.10.2. And different from the main version rebase, a major version rebase represents a rebase that goes from one major version to another. So for example, from Linux 4.10 to Linux 4.11. So group porting, individual picking, major version rebase, and main version rebase are some common passporting practices that we summarized. So, and different Linux distributions can employ several passporting practices to form their passporting strategies. So we summarized their passporting practices for different Linux distributions in this table. As you can see, basically for the Arch and the Fedora, what they choose are the major version rebase. At the same time, Fedora will also group port from the Linux runtime support or from Linux or group port from Linux stable branch. But for different from the Arch and Fedora, which frequently rebase, other branch, other distributions in this table usually stay on a single base for a long period. So they usually choose to group port from runtime support, group port from Linux stable, and also pick in packages from Linux mainline. So we also notice that sometimes even the same Linux distributions, for example, in here, the Ubuntu 16, Ubuntu 20, Ubuntu 22, their patch porting practices are the same, but for the Ubuntu 18, it is a little different from the other Ubuntu distribution branches. So, we previously said, our measurement target includes 468 commits for 16 different Linux distribution branches, and also 7 Linux runtime support branches. And then we define 3 measurement metrics to evaluate the different patch porting strategies. We use patch delay to measure the time difference between when the patch appears in the upstream and when it appears in a downstream Linux kernel branch. And we use the patch rate to measure the number of ported patches per day to compare the patching effort among different Linux distributions. At the same time, patch commits sometimes themselves can also introduce new bugs. So we use bug inheritance ratio to calculate the fraction of bugs introduced into Linux mainline that are inherited by a downstream kernel branch. So here it is the overall patch delay graph for all of the Linux distributions that we measured. As you can see that these two lines are for the Arch and Fedora. So Arch and Fedora frequently change their base from one major version to another. Usually it is every 2 to 3 months. So this is a very different strategy compared to staying on a single base for an extended period of time. So in terms of the patch delay, the frequently changing the rebase is a good strategy because it automatically inherits all commits from the upstream, allowing the downstream kernel branch to keep up with the latest patches. At the same time, when switching bases from one major version to another, branches also inherit new bugs, as well as patches from the Linux mainline. So, resulting in 100% bug inheritance ratio. So basically for the frequently changing rebase, the advantage is that they are better on the patch delay, but the disadvantage is that they are worse on bug inheritance ratio. It is a 100% bug inheritance ratio. We have a corresponding paper for this. In the paper, we also give the detailed analysis based on these 3 metrics to different the patch porting behaviors on these distributions, including all of the other distributions like Oracle UEK, SLE, Ubuntu, and Debian. So if you are interested, you can take a look at our paper. But now, due to the time, we ignore this. And then given that Frank related base inherits too many bugs from the Linux mainline, we now set this strategy aside and focus on the strategy of staying on single pass, single base. Ideally, for this strategy, we would like to see that the patches are ported as fast as possible and none of the necessary patches are missed. So we aim to analyze how far the downstream branch that follow this strategy, namely Linux Atom support branches, Oracle UEK, Ubuntu, SLE, Amazon, and Android are away from the ideal. So there are the two patch porting routes for the distributions. So the first is that patches are first ported from Linux mainline to the Linux long-term support branches, and then Linux distributions report patches from Linux long-term support branch to Linux distributions. And we try the patch delay for these two parts in this figure and in this figure. So for this figure, it clearly shows that Android is much better than other distributions on the patch delay for the group porting from the Linux long-term support branches. About 78% of patches in Android are ported from upstream within 1 day. One possible reason is that the main maintainer of Android is also the main maintainer of the Linux long-term support branches, so that patches can be ported timely. So, and another patch porting route is directly from the Linux mainline to the Linux distributions by the individual picking. We also try the patch delay for different Linux distributions in this graph. So, and then we look into the factors influencing the patch porting. So we know that the patch porting from the Linux mainline to Linux long-term support is an important step, as most distributions would have to wait for the patches to appear in Linux long-term support before they can port them to the Linux distributions. So which means that these distributions choose to group port from Linux long-term support branches. So then the patch porting from Linux mainline to Linux long-term support will be an important step. So we try to find some factors that influence the patch porting for this step. So in general, we know it is a challenging task for Linux long-term support maintainers to identify and pick patches from Linux mainline, as there are so many mainline commits that maintainers need to scan, usually a few hundreds daily. So therefore, it is possible that a mainline commit is mistaken, skipped, and then picked up at a later point after the community realized its importance. So we call a commit A as the out-of-order commits if there exists a later commit B in Linux mainline, whereas commit A is ported later to Linux long-term support than commit B. So at the same time, if commit A is ported to Linux long-term support before or later Linux mainline patches B, we consider commit A as the in-order commit. So as shown in this figure, we can notice that the patch delay of the in-order commits are much smaller than those out-of-order commits. So we can conclude that the out-of-order commits contribute to the big patch delay from the Linux mainline to Linux long-term support branches. And then we try to look into factors which contribute to the generation of these out-of-order commits. So we noticed that there are two types of tags provided in each Linux commit themselves that are designed to make the job of maintenance easier, which are the fixes tags and the CC stable tags. So fixes tags can tell maintainers the bug introducing commit, and the CC stable tags can tell maintainers that this is an important patch. So as you can see in this table, for in-order commits, the percent of commits with the percent of commits that are attached with these two tags are doubled than those out-of-order commits. So we think, so we conclude that the lack of source tags contributes to the generation of the out-of-order commits, which finally causes a long patch delay. And according to various public documents and our personal outreach to the Linux community, fixes tags and CC stable tags are indeed used in practice to determine whether a mainline patch will be ported. Besides, patch size is also a factor to the generation of out-of-order commits. Another interesting finding is that there are some idle periods when Linux distributes, such as Ubuntu 18.04, totally passes the group porting from Linux long-term support branch. We found that the reason is that maintainers are busy with other important tasks, such as picking patches from Linux mainline to fix CVE bugs, since CVE bugs are usually very serious in terms of security impact. So in fact, we also reached out to the Ubuntu maintainers directly. Interesting enough, we are told that those idle periods actually correspond to a period of time where the Ubuntu maintainers are busy with other important but unspecified tasks. So according to our observation, during such periods, there seems to an increased focus on picking patches for CVE bugs. There are 1.7 CVE patches per day were picked during this idle period. But at the same time, there is only 0.5 CVE patches per day on average during those non-idle periods. Here it is the table for the patch rates and the bug inheritance ratio for different Linux distributions. So there are also some interesting findings. For example, the SIOE branches is the highest on the patch rate. So in fact, it picks more patches per day compared to the Linux long-term support branches. So for example, for this SIOE version, its patch rate is 35 per day, where it's neighbor Linux long-term support branch, its patch rate is only about 19 per day. So, in fact, the SLE is patch porting strategy, is that it does the group porting initially from a stable branch and switch to exclusively picking from Linux mainline after the stable branch reaches the end of life. Effectively, SLE can be viewed as a maintaining its own Linux own long-term support branch. So the bug inheritance ratio is also much bigger in SLE branches than others, mainly contributed by the extensive picking from the Linux mainline. This is likely again because of the substantially higher patch rate. We also have some comparison between the picked commits and the commits in the corresponding Linux long-term support branches. So as we can see, a fraction of patches ported by the Linux distributions end up being buggy patches, which introducing new bugs. So in other words, there are significant regulation issues in patches for Linux mainline. So interestingly, we note that there is a chance to mitigate these issues. The observation is that it is possible those buggy patches are already have fixes in the Linux mainline when distributions pick these buggy patches themselves. So as a concrete example, so in Oracle UEK, there are around 60% to 70% of buggy patches introduced by picking are fixed within 1 day. This is likely because Oracle UEK looked ahead to see if these picked patches on Linux mainline have the corresponding fix already. If so, they also ported these fixes as well. However, other distributions does not seem to have adopted this method. Using SLE as an example, only 23.2% to 6.4% of picked buggy patches are fixed within 1 day. And also, in this table, we can notice that there are around 3.3% to 18% of picked commits that are ported into distributions before Linux long-term support branches, and about 30% of Linux long-term support missed picked patches could possibly also be necessary for Linux long-term support branches. Also, the picking behaviors by the Linux distributions are dramatically different even for the same based distribution. So therefore, it is useful for the distribution and the maintainers to review each other's patches to minimize missed patches. Furthermore, So we suggest that the Linux community to collectively build a unified bug tracking system so they can all benefit and quickly port important patches. And we note that only a small fraction of them have tags, which is another evidence that source picking are driven by other the picking by the Linux distributions are driven by other external signals. So more importantly, for patches with tags, we found that roughly 20% to 30% of patches should have been ported to the Linux long-term support because the buggy commits give as shown in the fixes tags do appear in Linux long-term support. Interestingly, the remaining 80% to the remaining 70% to 80% are cases where buggy commits themselves are not in long-term support. Upon a closer inspection. This is because the bug commits are inherited by distributions exclusively through their picked patches. So this is the same that we reported earlier about a higher bug inheritance ratio as a result of a higher patch rate. So, and the fact based on this, we provide several suggestions to improve the patch porting practice. So, patch, for the patch authors, they should increase the awareness and the willingness to attach tags. Also, for the maintainers, an automatically patch relevance analysis tool is important. And for distributions maintainers, it also should be noted that the regression should be mitigated. And for the community, the cross validation system for all the Linux startup support and the distributions are required. And that's all what I wanted to present for today. Any questions? At the same time, I'm also looking for an intern or a full-time job. If you can contact me by this email. Thanks.
I have a question. This is Joe Salisbury from Oracle. So in one of your tables, the comparison between pick commits and commits and corresponding LTS branches, you don't down a couple more. It's the table where you compare the pick commits versus the LTS branches.
Yeah.
Right. Yes. So is there a specific date range that you utilized for that data? Was it for a full year? Was it for a month or a specific month? Because I do know with the Oracle UEK, for example, there's the data does vary depending on the time of year, based on around the holidays that there's, the kernels are stabilized. So commits aren't generally picked in, say November, December timeframes. And then some companies also have end of year shutdowns, things like that. So was this data for, a full year or a specific month or
something? It is for its overall lifetime for different Oracle, for different branches.
Okay, is this for all time, since the start of the branch, or, is it for a specific year?
Yeah.
Okay, all time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, for what you just described, we also noticed that there are some periods of inactivity of the patch porting. So we noticed this that in the Ubuntu branches.
What is the inherited regressions? For me, when I'm backporting a fix, I'll backport the fix, and then I'll backport the fix, which fixes the fix. Is that an inherited regression, or is that not? I don't know how you're counting inherited bug.
So I think that this is because sometimes the patch will also introduce these new bugs. So our suggestion is that maintainers should look ahead for the Linux mainline. So when they when they port a specific patch, and if this patch also introduce a new bug, so also usually this time this patch is not on the Linux mainline. So there are maybe several warnings before or earlier than the Linux, than the latest Linux mainline. So it's possible that the latest Linux mainline already fixed this bug. So so in this case, that maintainers maybe can choose to look ahead in the Linux mainline to see if this bug, if this patch introduced a bug, if the latest mainline already fixed this bug. So they can utilize the fixed tag to say that if to assist in this process.
We have time for maybe one or two more questions. Any questions here? All right, and I didn't see any questions on the chat, so I think we're all set. Thank you very, very much.
Okay, thanks.